and a beautiful rendition of some gorgeous theme in art. It actually goes back to the Mesopotamian times, back in the empire of the Euphrates and the Tigris and the Assyrians and the like. The Babylonians actually practiced some of this mosaic art, and the Romans brought it to prominence with the secularization of art back in the early Roman Empire before Christ. However, it was in the fourth century AD that we ever see for the first time any of the Christian relics or Christian art coming into prominence, and that of course was in the catacombs in Rome. And right here in the 6th century, when Justinian was building up the cathedral that you see behind us right here, that was initially a cathedral, you can see now it's a mosque. It was turned into a mosque, Hagia Sophia, back in the 15th century by the Ottoman Turks as well, when they came and they took the city, and they of course turned such a magnificent monument and structure that you see behind us right here, which was the greatest church in Christendom for some 1,000 years. They turned it into a mosque, and you see the mosque turrets behind us as well. But it is a fantastic building. This is what Justinian did. He actually started glorifying this structure, not just the structure itself, but Christ and of course the apostles, with the fantastic mosaics that are inside it. My gosh, when I went into this museum right here, they turned it into a museum back in that 1935, when Ataturk, Mustafa Kemal, the liberator of all Turkey, actually turned it into a museum. There's no religious ceremony whatsoever in the building now. It's entirely a museum. You can go into the beautiful museum, and you can go up into the upper reaches of it and see these beautiful mosaics of Christ and the apostles, Mary and John the Baptist, and there's some fantastic mosaics in there. Of course, you can see how these mosaics have been very, very finely laid. There's a few different types of ways in which mosaics can be created. First of all is the direct method, and that's where it's a painstaking application. That's where you actually have to be right there on site to create it, and it's where the artist has to actually lay down each and every piece on the panel right there in the spot that it's going to go up. That's the most difficult, because you have to be on site to do it. The second and more commonly used mosaic type back in the ages and also today is to actually do it with an indirect method, and that is where you actually in a studio use a gauze kind of mat and you place the mosaic face down onto that mat. The only difference with a problem with that is you cannot see exactly what you are creating, so that then when it is actually transposed you can move it in gauze sections like a meter or a couple feet squared and actually move that across onto the wall and then apply it with the kind of grouting type material that goes between each of the pieces. Or there's the double indirect method, and that's where you do it in a similar fashion onto the gauze, but you place it down with face up, so you can actually see, the artist can see exactly what they're creating, exactly the style that they're putting down onto this gauze plate, and then they will actually transfer it, and they'll put gauze on the other side and actually move and very painstakingly just remove the back part of the gauze, so that then they can lay it face up onto the wall that they're going to create it on. Mosaics being used through the ages. In fact, it was in the 16th century, and there's many other usages of mosaic, not just in the ancient world, but into the modern world as well, right through the Renaissance, into the Baroque, and then on into the modern day as well. In the modern day, you'll see works. We went to Barcelona recently, and I showed the mosaics in Güell Park, right there, that Gaudi created back in Barcelona, back in the late 19th century, early 20th century. And of course St. Peter's Basilica back when they were redoing the St. Peter's Basilica Cathedral in Rome, the beautiful ceilings are laid out in mosaic. It's quite phenomenal how that's been done on that ceiling that's so high up in the air, literally 100 meters in the air, and these tiny little pieces of stone and marble being used for that exact purpose. But there are other examples of mosaic, and perhaps some of the best preserved from antiquity are in Sicily and Ravenna, Italy. There's also some beautiful mosaics in Venice, and when you get a chance to go to Venice, go to St. Mark's Basilica, right there in the middle of St. Mark's Square. In St. Mark's Basilica, the gorgeous mosaics from the 11th and 12th century that were created in honor of the Venetians and in honor of Christ, and also honor of St. Mark himself, the evangelist, whom that city is has really risen to prominence with the backing of, so to speak, throughout the Italian Renaissance and before. But of course, Hagia Sophia actually holds some of the greatest, oldest mosaics in the world, and when you are here in Istanbul, you must come and see them. They call the mosaics paintings that last for eternity. That is essentially because they're not paintings per se, but they reflect light. The reason why they've been used and they've been put down is that they will put down the mosaic in kind of not in a uniform manner. They'll actually put it on different angles so that it catches light in different angles. And you'll see these magnificent up in the rafters right here, these magnificent windows in Hagia Sophia that let in light spectacularly and shine up on these mosaics in the beautiful church right here. But of course, the Turks actually took the mosaics and covered them up. There were a few different periods of Byzantine art that must be kind of understood. Byzantine art came to prominence, of course, in the 6th century, and then the 7th century, and then the 8th century as well. But in 726, Emperor Leo III took an edict from the Pope and said that basically icons were not going to be allowed to be used ever in the whole empire. And what we had then was an opportunity, for the next 130 years, there were no such thing as icons in any of the empire, so it was all destroyed. What we then found was then 843 AD, they were allowed back into the empire, and they went on in the 9th century, so many more mosaics, and some of these mosaics in this museum right here date from that period. And then there was the time when in 1204, the Fourth Crusade with the Venetians sacking Constantinople, taking it back for the Roman Catholic Church, and a lot of the icons were destroyed at that stage. And then, of course, after they took it back, the Eastern Empire came back into force in 1261 through to 1453 with the Ottomans coming into town. They basically took it back and started creating it again. So there were three periods of Byzantine art. I tell you what, that's a bit about Eastern mosaics and how important it is to the church in modern day. It's because, paintings don't last as long as these magnificent mosaics. We're talking about some of these paintings and creations being over 1500, 1600 years old. I mean, absolutely fantastic and amazing. I'll tell you what, from Istanbul in modern day Turkey, the old Constantinople and Byzantium, right here in the heart of the Eastern Roman Empire. My name is Andre Knott for blankcanvastv.com. We are changing the way you see and experience art. We will see you on another episode.